On a winter Sunday I go to clear away the snow and green the ground below. April all an ocean away. Is this a better way to spend the day? Keeping the winter at bay. What were the words I meant to say before you left? When I could see your breath lead where you were going to. Maybe I should just let it be. And maybe it will all come back to me. Sing, oh, January. Oh. How I lived a childhood in snow, and all my teens in tow. Stuffed in a strata of glow. Hail the winter days after dark, wandering the gray memorial park, the fleeting of beating hearts. What were the words I meant to say before she left? When I could see her breath lead where she was going to. Maybe I should just let it be. And maybe it will all come back to me. Sing, oh, January. Oh, January.
So beautiful. It's a Decemberist song called January Hymn. So there you go. That's why you get that song once a year. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Welcome to Peace on a cold and sunny day. I can take almost anything if the sun's shining, right? Good morning to those of you at home on Zoom, too. We see you, and we're waving to you and greeting you as well. We've gathered here in our space downtown in Kansas City and around town and around the country on Zoom too, to worship together like we do every week during special seasons and also ordinary time. We gather here to hear one another's joys and concerns, to pray with one another and for one another, to sing and to listen for a word of God's good hope and peace for the world. If you're able, please stand and we'll sing our opening. The words are printed in your bulletin and also will be on the screen.
Come darkness, come light, come new star shining bright. Come love to this world tonight. Alleluia. Come darkness, come light. Come new star shining bright. Come love to this world tonight. Alleluia.
Sound in very good voice this morning. We're going to sing Rise Up Shepherd and Follow as our opening song.
Oh.
Okay. Oh, that was going to be a soprano train wreck.
There's a star in the east on Christmas.
shepherd and follow. It will lead to the place where the Christ was born. Rise up, shepherd, and follow.
Come with the shepherds and the angels to follow the one who calls us to embrace one another and the world. Thankful for this community of challenge and encouragement. The peace of God be with you all.
And also with you.
Take a moment, share a word, a sign of peace with those around you. Peace, peace. Good to see you. Good to be together. Good to be together. Thank you so much for being with us. It's great to see you and wonderful to see you all up there on our Zoom stained glass. Thank you so much for being with us, kind of far and wide from warm places to cold places. Thanks for your presence with us. We want to be sure that we know that you are here, so please let us know your name in the chat. And same thing with the green books, if you can pass those down and pass them back. I really do look at those all week long and think about folks and pray for folks. And it's a good place to let us know joys and concerns that we might not be aware of. You can always make your offering at the baskets by the door or in the chat link. We're still continuing to receive our Christmas Eve offering. We are this close to $5,000, and that offering will be divided between Micah Ministries, folks who are living close to the streets here in Kansas City, and this Welcome Refugee Program, where we're hoping as a congregation to help resettle refugees. So we very much appreciate your support of that. We have lots of joys to celebrate later at the service. We're going to honor a couple of our graduates who just finished up at Christmas, so we're excited about that. And Micah Holmes is headed after 7 months of cancer treatment over there at the little net cap. He's going to be at Truman State, and his parents are taking him off to Truman State, and I know he's going to really be ready to do that, as well as you all. So we're sure thinking of you and praying for you. And then we've got, lots of folks with lots of things going on. Last week was a week when a couple people in the church kind of began the process of finalizing a divorce. We've got different people who are in the job shift change, and so lots of things like that going on. And our own Mark Williams is going to have surgery a week from Monday, so we're thinking of him too and hope that that goes as smoothly as possible. And I think many of you saw, we mentioned in Peace News that Sheila Holt and Nedra Jeffries, we think of them because the 22-year-old niece was killed tragically in a car wreck just on Christmas Eve, just 2 months after she was married. So we're really holding them very closely as well as their family tries to process that really devastating loss. And of course, we continue to pray for this whole wide world. We think of the ongoing war in Ukraine and especially the war that's going on in the Middle East between particularly Hamas and Israel. Today, a dear friend of mine, Rabbi Alpert, is going to speak and is going to share, many of his understandings and thoughts, too, as we think about how do we move forward into a world of peace. I was with a good friend from Austin this week, and she asked me, she goes, what have you been preaching on? And I started to say, Gaza. But I didn't say that because she'd already told me she wasn't really paying much attention. So I said, oh, I'm going to talk about this and that. And I thought, well, the real honest truth, and I told her later, is really thinking about that situation. In some ways, because it's not just like any conflict. I mean, Israel is the number one recipient of U.S. foreign aid. We know that we're deeply involved in this conflict, whether or not we want to be or not. And there's a lot of reverberations that we see in our own culture. Many people will say Netanyahu, is like Trump with a better command of the English language. That's Rabbi's quote. But anyway, but then Hamas, the terror, the ISIS, the Islamic Jihad, that whole, and we see that whole quick openness to violence in our own culture. So we think about what does this kind of conflict say to us? How does it touch us? And there's a lot going on there too in our own personal lives, you know, our tendency to other people, to push other people away. And then there's also the way that we process our own trauma, you know, whether it's the Holocaust, whether it's the transatlantic slave trade, the Nakba, whether it's our own trauma, how do we take that and use it as a way that we connect with other people, right? How do we take our own suffering and let it be a bridge to others so that we can move forward together? And one of the reasons that I appreciate Doug so much is I find people who are deeply involved in trying to transform this world, who are deeply connected to having really honest, genuine relationships, are the most enlivening people to be around. And I was blessed to really get to know Doug maybe a dozen or so years ago when Kolami, he started a new urban Jewish congregation similar to Peace without a building. And then in the last 7 or 8 years, we've really become, I'd say, very close friends through a weekly Torah study. And I think many of you know that there's 14 clergy in Missouri who are suing to reverse the Missouri abortion bans. And most of those clergy are in St. Louis. And Doug and I are the two plaintiffs here in Kansas City. So I think we both felt, well, hey, there's somebody else standing by me during this process. But Doug has been a voice for hope and justice and peace throughout this city. He spoke the March for Our Lives, you know, when March after Trump was elected and many of us gathered, I could hear Doug's voice, you know, kind of across the giant group of people speaking a word of hope and peace and how do we move forward. So we're super thankful for his presence this morning. His wonderful wife, Faye, has made my gorgeous necklace. So dear friend, and he also accompanied Joe to the disastrous chief loss on Christmas Day. So we appreciate you doing that too. But anyway, so we really look forward to hearing your words. And we also come here knowing that we are all holding a lot. Everybody's carrying stuff, right? We've got people with the exciting expectation of a new life coming into the world, others sending a child off, and others, you know, in a tender spot. Mm-hmm. So we hold one another in this world closely as we sing our call to prayer.
For more love, more joy and laughter,
I hope.
You'll have more than you'll ever need.
I hope.
We'll have more happy ever afters.
I hope.
We can all live more fearlessly, and we can lose all the pain and misery. Joy and laughter.
I hope
you'll have more than you'll ever need.
I hope
we'll have more happy ever afters.
I hope
we can all live more fearlessly, and we can lose all the pain and misery. I hope, I hope.
Lord, we are gathered at Peace Church, praying and working towards peace, but living in a world mostly devoid of it. So today I make a stoic entreaty for each of us to find some. A few weeks ago, we heard the angels say, "Peace on earth, goodwill towards man." Yet peace is elusive, not only because our world seems at odds with the concept. If we are willing to pay attention, tragedy, terror, and devastated children paint our screens. And even if we aren't, how does one find peace in contemporary day-to-day struggles to simply keep up? Putting find peace on the to-do list is ineffective. It's mostly counteractive by every other item on the list. Distraction we find easy. Peace is hard. Let us find a bit this week. Amen.
For more love, more joy and laughter,
I hope
you'll have more than you'll ever need.
I hope
we'll have more happy ever afters.
I hope
we can all live more fearlessly, and we can lose all the pain and misery. I hope, I hope.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's always good to be back here at Peace Church. And thanks my colleague, my dear friend, Pastor Holly McKissick, for her very generous introduction. I'm standing back. I'm on the tail end of COVID. I'm past the incubation period, but I'm still trying to be careful. So if I don't engage you more directly this morning, that's the reason why. It's not because I don't want to. In fact, it's been a little torturous having to kind of seclude myself. I'm not used to that, and I missed a few things recently, like a wedding I was supposed to do for a dear friend, and makes me think about others who have to confront illness and how it can be, if not kind of, in a way, kind of marginalizing. It kind of makes me more cognizant of the need to connect with people who are separated from community due to illness. Couple of prefatory comments before I kind of get into Israel a little bit. And when I do get into Israel, I'm going to give you a little my own background, my life story, like in 2 minutes or less in relation to Israel, and then my own perspective on where we are right now. And then hopefully most of what will happen this morning is questions and discussion. I'm really looking forward to that piece more than anything else. The prefatory part is you're not getting the Jewish opinion, you're getting a Jewish opinion. You probably heard this saying, the only thing two Jews can agree on is how much the third Jew should be giving the synagogue. So keep that in mind. And I have kind of glommed on to something that President Obama said about the conflict, and which is, we are really compelled in this moment to hold on to multiple conflicting truths. And for me, I am dubious, wary, skeptical of anyone who asserts that they've got this figured out with any level of certainty. I have been, as you can imagine, inundated with different perspectives and differing views and people in my rabbinic world who are struggling as to the best path forward. And for me, that usually means the rabbinic community that's on the progressive side of things. So I say this as somebody who's on this path of struggle to try and figure out what is the best path forward. And finally, a side note and a personal one. Tonight and tomorrow is my father's yahrzeit. It's been 36 years since he died, and we always, every year, we honor memory in that way. And there's a prayer we say, and we come together as community to honor each other's own memory. So I think he would have been really happy that I'm here talking to you all this morning. So in that sense, my comments, I really dedicate to his memory. So, my little life story. Way back when, and I know, in a log cabin, my first Hebrew school teacher was nothing, and for us, Hebrew school started in the third grade. And she was my Hebrew school teacher for 3 years, and she and her husband ended up being family friends, Tzivi and Joe Gaba. They were very Israel-centric, and that's the kind of Jewish education I grew up on, was a very Israel-centric Jewish education. Wasn't the only thing that was discussed, but it was always front and center. Tzivi and Joe were what is known as chalutzim, which means Israeli pioneers. They were among the Zionists who settled the land of Israel, Haaretz, the land. We only later found out, much later in life, that they were gunrunners for the Irgun. I would have found that a much more interesting story, particularly as a kid. But it kind of tells you where they were. And in the after the Six-Day War in 67, you know, the big song, the big new song in the Jewish world was Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, Jerusalem of Gold. And to get the solo, to be able to sing it, was a big deal. And we always had this sense that Israel was not just a religiously central piece to us, it was the Jewish moral center. We kind of glommed on to the idea of the Golda Meir's famous saying, which is, we can forgive you for killing our kids, we cannot forgive you for compelling us to kill your kids. So we had this sense of, I'll say it, Jewish exceptionalism back then. And I personally retained that for a long, long time. Fast forward to when my boys were in high school and I was still am in some ways, but not the same way, active in the Jewish community. Two of my three boys, my two older boys, both did high school semesters in Israel during the Second Intifada. I actually was on a mission during the Second Intifada with seven other national Jewish leaders. You could roll a bowling ball through downtown Jerusalem and not hit a soul. So the commitment to Israel had remained strong even then. And the change started to occur, and it's been a long time since I've been, actually. There was a period of time where I was in Israel, I think, 9 times in 7 years. And the last time when I was in seminary, I don't know if it was 2009, 2010, I was there in the summer to do some studying, and then my wife Faye came over, and I'd always loved Jerusalem. It was always my favorite place to visit in Israel for its spiritual significance for me. It was different the last time I was there. There was a sense of animosity and wariness of the other, and it was reflected both outside of the Jewish community toward the Israeli Arab community. We had caught a cab right after Shabbat to go have dinner, and the cab driver said, "It's good you got in my cab because the next cab is being driven by an Arab." We found that incredibly upsetting. And there was animosity within the Jewish community. So one of the books I brought, and I may talk more about it in a bit, is this book called The Holocaust is Over, We Must Rise from Its Ashes by Avraham Berg. Berg was a speaker of the Knesset, the Israeli parliament, and I had a colleague here in town who knew I was going to Israel and says, "Can you get a copy of this book in Hebrew?" So I went into a bookstore and said, "I want to get a copy of this book." She literally walked out of the store and stood out in front of the store, not refusing to wait on me until I left. I had never had that kind of experience before from Jew to Jew. So it already was starting to feel different, and where I always had loved Jerusalem and Tel Aviv less so, the last trip I came to love Tel Aviv and saw that as the real dream of Israel and of the Jewish people, which is sitting in a cafe. There's a street in Tel Aviv called Bialik Street. It's after the first poet laureate of Israel, Chaim Bialik. His house is on that street. There are Israeli artists who lived on that street. And at the front of the street, the head of the street, there's the Bialik Cafe. And there are all these Jews sitting around, you know, drinking espresso, smoking, because you get, you know, a fuller sense of the experience that way. You know, and even in my very challenged Hebrew, you know, they were arguing with each other, but arguing with each other kind of in a joyous way. And that's my dream of Israel, is to sit in a cafe and be who we are without having to look over our shoulder and wonder what's going to happen. But I kind of feel that dream is losing itself. And what's going on now, what's been going on for a while, has made us kind of less of who we are, or really at least who I think we should be and who we want to be. So that brings me to where we are right now. Netanyahu, as Holly alluded to, not my favorite person. Unless you're a Trump lover, then if you say Netanyahu's Trump with a better command in the English language, then yeah, you think, you know, you can add it to Trump's list of favorite dictators and authoritarian figures. But in relation to what's going on right now and Netanyahu's desire to stay out of jail for corruption, bribery, go down the whole list, amongst the people, so another topic for another day is Israeli's coalition government and the challenges that poses, but he had a bare majority, and it was really plurality and not a full majority, so he had to put together a coalition government. Two of the people he appointed, Ben-Gvir and Smotrich, they're domestic terrorists. They were part of what is of their Kahanis. Mayor, the late Mayor Kahani was a Jewish domestic terrorist, and they are too. And basically, Netanyahu turned them loose on the West Bank. And they have encouraged, supported, participated with the Israeli settler movement, which I think the best way I can describe it is misguided, to really violate Palestinian rights in the West Bank. And at the very least, Netanyahu turned a very conscious blind eye to what's going on. Well, when you do that, it necessitated more of an army, an IDF presence in the West Bank, so it was fewer IDF soldiers down south on the border with Gaza. In addition to that, Netanyahu didn't care too much about the Israeli Jews and the kibbutzim down south near the Gaza border because they were peaceniks. And they weren't his people. They weren't the people voting for Netanyahu. So he was fine leaving them vulnerable. He was propping up Hamas in order to diminish the power of PLA in the West Bank, which was also the nicest thing you could say about it is a misguided strategy. So all of this led to it being more and more probable that something bad would happen on the Gaza-Israeli border. And lo and behold, it did. Now, I say all this without giving any excuse to Hamas. And for those who question about what they did, I, as a very progressive Jew, have no question that what they did was horrific, violent, stomach-turning. Rape as a tool of war and a political tool is beyond excusable, and I have no excuse for them. And I honestly think the world would be a better place without them. But that said, the notion of Israel eradicating Hamas, I think, is a fool's errand. I don't think, at the very least, in this, you know, leveling Gaza in order to eradicate Hamas, you're creating the next generation of Hamas. And that is my ultimate fear. All that said, I don't see a short-term good outcome. There is nothing that's going to happen good in the short term. So what I am striving for in this space and in this moment is, and then what? I am really focused on, and then what? And if I have any glimmer of hope is that as tragedy occurs on a daily basis, that there is also more and more discussion, believe it or not, of a two-state solution. A whole other discussion whether you think it ought to be one unified Israel or some kind of two-state solution or something on the model of the EU. If there's some sense of peace and we're getting along and we're honoring each other's dignity and humanity, then I'm good regardless of the structure. Which is also to say, in regard to this striving for and then what, I've reached out to Palestinians here in town. I've had a couple of good discussions. I don't know where it will lead. One of the women is got family in Gaza, and I worry and pray for her family every day. And you know where things go and what happens can change our ability to be in discussion with each other. But I'm a rabbi. Optimism and hope is in my job description, so I continue to lay in that space. So in those discussions, the things we talked of, the things I really asserted in the discussion is to move forward, we're going to have to, one, recognize the pain of the other. For Palestinians, it's Nakba, and an ongoing fear of displacement, as was the case in 48. For Jews, it's the Holocaust. And that represents much of the response of Israeli Jews, Jews here in the States, to what happened on October 7th. Both responses are valid and real. And as I told these wonderful Palestinian women, I said, until we recognize the pain of the other and recognize each other's humanity and dignity, we're not going to be able to move forward. So I mentioned this book. This book suggests, speaking of the Holocaust, that we using, you know, however valid the response is to not wanting one-third of our people to be slaughtered again, 6 million people, it doesn't necessarily make for good policy and get us closer to peace. And that's really the thrust of Berg's book. The other book that I would say from a quasi-political, philosophical standpoint is this book, Peter Beinart's Crisis of Zionism. By the way, words like, you know, are you a Zionist, are you pro-Zionist, are you anti-Zionist, I think is a distraction. There are, even before all this, there were like five different types of categories of Zionist. Again, another discussion. But, you know, somebody, I got on a meeting of folks advocating for a ceasefire, and they saw the one rabbi was on, that's really great. Glad that rabbi's an anti-Zionist. Well, I'm not an anti-Zionist. I'm not sure what I am in relation to that, but it's a distraction. Peter Beinart wrote this book in 2014, so well before this. And Beinart's, and you'll see Peter Beinart wrote for The Atlantic, and now he writes for a progressive Jewish publication called Jewish Currents. He's been on MSNBC from time to time. And his question for us Jews is this: are we going to be perpetually the world's victim for all eternity? And if we're not a victim, how do we respond when we're no longer see ourselves as a victim's role? So that's Beinart. He's shifted from a two-state solution to a one-state solution. I'm not sure whether he's still there or not, but I like Beinart. The other two books I brought are this one, I Shall Not Hate, by Izzeldin Abulesh. He is a doctor who lived in Gaza who lost a wife and daughter to an Israeli bomb and has been ever since an advocate for peace. He actually got a lot of his medical training in Israel, so he had that contact. I don't think he lives in Israel, or he doesn't live in Gaza anymore, but I take a lot from what he wrote. And then the other book is In This Place Together, A Palestinian Journey to Collective Liberation, written by Penina Eilberg-Schwartz. Penina's mother, Rabbi Amy Eilberg, was the first woman to be ordained as a rabbi by the conservative Jewish movement. And Suleiman Khatib actually stabbed an Israeli police officer in the West Bank and was in jail for a period of years and came out a peace activist. So that is where I draw my inspiration and my hope.
So this is just kind of a question / comment about Doug. The other thing you have to know about Doug is the congregation he has founded and led, it has become a home for, you know, trans, queer, LGBTQ, young Jewish folks, and just across the breadth, kind of just a really welcoming place, a place where interfaith dialogue happens, a place where they're deeply involved with many of the same causes we are, working with the migrant farm workers, et cetera. And so I guess the thing I would say is kind of a question / is, you know, just as we think about the global, how it is that we dig in locally, and again, how just in your own personal life, you have used, again, the own hurts you've had as a way of bridging and reaching out to others.
The most oft-repeated commandment in our written Torah in the five books of Moses is some variation of how we treat the stranger. And it is central to my theological perspective in that, and by the way, part of that perspective is I always see Judaism as more behavior-based theology than faith-based theology. I mean, on the front end, you kind of buy into the idea of the God you can't touch, talk to directly, whatever. We look for evidence of God's creative world and God's presence in that world. But you got there's a little bit of a faith buy-in on the front end, but after that, the way Jews connect to God is through how we behave. And so we tell you how to act in exhaustive detail. Bar-Ilan University did a survey of Jewish codes of law, Jewish sources of law. They came up with 9 single-space pages of sources of law. It's a rabbinic student's nightmare. But you know, the idea of how we treat the stranger and the many times it's repeated in the 5 books of Moses starts out as don't oppress the stranger, evolves into from a negative, a prohibitive commandment, what you don't do, to what you are obligated to do, which is to love the stranger. And ultimately, you should love the stranger because God loves the stranger. That ends up in Deuteronomy. And why? Because we were strangers in the land of Egypt, because we knew what it was like to be a stranger. And if you plug in to what it's like to be that stranger, to be marginalized, to be oppressed, you would never want anyone else to feel that way. And that is really the driving force behind everything we do at Kol Ami. And it always remains front and center in how we act in the world and how we act in the community. And as I've told people in regard to the present, you know, war and all that I'm troubled about, you know, nobody's coming to me to sign any agreements. I'm not signing anybody's anything away. I'm not at the negotiating table with Secretary Blinken. I can only do what I can do. And I think what I can do is to reach out in our local community and forge the best relationships that we can possibly forge.
This is a song by Steve Earle.
I woke up this morning and none of the news was good, and death machines were rumbling across the ground where Jesus stood. And the man on my TV told me it had always been that way, and there was nothing anyone could do or say. And I almost listened to him. Yeah, I almost lost my mind, but I regained my senses again and looked into my heart to find that I believe one fine day all the children of Abraham will lay down their swords forever in Jerusalem. Well, maybe I'm only dreaming, maybe I'm just a fool, but I don't remember learning how to hate in Sunday school. But somewhere along the way I strayed and I never looked back again, but I still find some comfort now and then. And the storm comes rumbling in, and I can't lay me down, and the drums are drumming again, and I can't stand the sound. But I believe there will come a day when the lion and the lamb will lie down in peace together in Jerusalem. There'll be no barricades then. There will be no wire or walls. We can wash all this blood from our hands and all this hatred from our souls. And I believe that on that day all the children of Abraham will lay down their swords forever in Jerusalem. I believe that on that day, all the children of Abraham will lay down their swords forever in Jerusalem.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. What a gift, what a gift. And Rabbi, thank you. One thing I meant to say in the introduction was talking about how, you know, we welcome the stranger and we connect with other people. I went through a really rough point in my life about 12 years ago, and Doug was one of the people who really helped pull me out of that, getting more involved with things that I had always been involved with. I remember being at a meeting and having gone through a time just feeling lost for myself, and Doug speaking and thinking, I used to be like that, and that's really been a great gift, so I really appreciate it. It's very, very, very important. One of the things I have been doing since October 7th, Monday through Friday, when I don't have another conflict, is at 2 o'clock, 2 to 2:30, there is a half-hour power hour with Jewish Voices for Peace, and there's 500, 600 people on this webinar, and you can only see the people leading. And then we hear a little bit of an update, and then we take some kind of action. Maybe it's calling representatives, maybe it's calling the New York Times or MSNBC, kind of trying to appeal for better coverage. But one of the things that the woman who moderates it always says is, you know, she talks about the chat and what you can and cannot put in the chat. And she said, before you put anything in the chat, ask yourself, is it true? Is it kind? Is it helpful? Is it true? Is it kind? Is it helpful? And I think about, you know, we gather at this table every week, and we don't have this idea that we break this bread and it metaphysically becomes Jesus' body. It's more like we come to this point, we break the bread, we're reminded of how we're a part of the brokenness, and how at the same time we're a part of the healing as well. And I think that little mantra might be a helpful one too as we gather every week around this, to think about our own actions for the week. Have they been true? Have they been kind? Have they been helpful? And if not, how can we move in that direction? And so we gather at this table every week, and we remember that it was on the night of the betrayal when Christ Jesus took bread and after giving thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, the cup after supper, saying, "This cup has been poured out for the forgiveness of all sins. Drink this as often as you do it in remembrance of me." Let us pray.
Holy One, even in moments when our hearts are shattered, we are reminded by the presence of people who show love and care and deep, deep thoughtfulness and hope for this world, that shattered, broken things can still be made whole, that shattered, broken hearts can still scatter love all over this planet, that shattered and broken things can be so jagged and ragged and also so incredibly beautiful too. And so as we share in this bread that has been broken, we ask that we might be reminded of the ways that we can still be your presence and hope and peace for all of this world. We ask your blessing on this bread and this cup as we share in it. And may we also be reminded that we do all of these things not alone, but together with one another and together with you. And so we pray the words that Jesus taught: Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Come and feast.
I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined and heard my cry. He lifts me up out of the pit, out of the mire and clay. And I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song. How long to sing this song? How sing this song. How long, how long, how long, how long to sing this song? He sets my feet upon a rock, made my footsteps firm. Many will see and hear. Sing, sing a new song. I will sing, sing a new song. And I will sing, sing a new song. I will sing, sing a new song. How long to sing this song? How long to sing this song? How long, how long, how long, how long to sing this song? I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined and heard my cry. He lifts me up out of the pit, out of the mire and clay. And I will sing, sing a new song. I will sing, sing a new song. How long to sing this song? Sing this song. How long, how long, how long, how long to sing this song?
Well, I think before we go on to anything else, we're going to invite our recent grads, Taylor and Julia, to come up. Julia's heading up all the way from the back classroom with the kiddos. Here, I'll pass you this.
Yeah, in case a few of you are wondering what happened to the children, you know, we have changed the storage room into this really hip, cool children's room back there.
Yeah.
So you can, like, take a look at it. It looks really good. We've kind of transformed it. We had to push the booze and other stuff away, you know, and kind of build a little barrier. But anyway, okay, you all come over here so everybody can see you. Paul and I are going to both say a word. Yep. So we are honoring two of our December grads, right? Taylor Duncan just finished at Emporia State, and she's just done her student teaching in Olathe, and she's going to be starting teaching there full-time at Olathe North in the fall. English teaching high school. She's going to be teaching teaching English, right? In this, until then, she's going to be doing kind of a long-term sub, so she's kind of putting that together. And I just have to say, and then Julia Chamberlain just graduated from Drury, where she's been doing acting and communications and all kinds of rich, incredible things. And I just have to say, I was there the day these two young women were born. And that is just, in fact, Rabbi wasn't 100% sure he could be here this morning. I was like, okay, I got stories about them ready to share. But just to say what an incredible gift and honor it is to stand here and to see how you have gone from a tiny little thing to this beautiful, amazing, radiant source of energy and hope in the world. And, you know, you hate to be those people who go, oh, the young people are the future, but the young people are the future, right? So, and we have a very simple gift for you. We got a little peace pendant thing that's super cool that you can put on a little jean jacket or wherever you want. And so anyway, and we hope that every time you touch that, you will think about this community here that adores you and loves you and is right here for you.
Okay. Amen. Yeah, and just to add to that, this time after graduation, you know, it's the first time you don't go to school.
like it's the first time you're done with all of it.
Although
and you've
Taylor's
got
starting a grad
right program. You got a grad program. Yeah, it's the first time you're fully opting into it, but it's this time, you know, you've got this time now before you start the job, and you've got this time now of graduating and looking forward of what's next. And it's an in-between space, and in-between spaces I think are the very most sacred spaces. They're the space for question and growth and for a little bit of uncertainty, but in the uncertainty that I think the challenge and the gift and the call of knowing you have a community who's here to catch you and love you is to explore and let yourself question and let yourself just like reach out and be big and be bold. And we're so proud of you. Yeah. We love you. Yeah. Well, on that note, let's join in a moment of prayer. Holy One, to see our young people growing up, to see our children playing, to hear the distant sounds of their laughter and their thoughtful voices, to hear a word so filled with hope and promise, to hear music and prayer that lifts our spirits, and to see your face shining in one another. We have indeed found your presence here today. May it carry us into this week as people who are hopeful and enlivened to do your work. Amen. All right, we are going to sing together our closing song before we hear our before we do our sung benediction and our spoken benediction. So if you're able, please stand and we'll sing together, Let There Be Peace on Earth.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God our Creator, children all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Love, give me peace on earth, give me life, give me life, keep me free from birth, give me hope, help me cope with this heavy load, trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. That I might understand you, give me love.
And now, may God, who loves each one of us as if we were the only one and somehow loves all of us the same, send us from this place to welcome the other so that everywhere we go, we might be peace and wage peace and love one another. Every single other. Amen.